in areas. As you know, that there are always certain learning objectives that at the conclusion of this lecture, you should be able to enlist the different parts of the skull, describe types of neurocranium and its derivatives, that what are the structures derived from which type of the neurocranium. So we will specifically focus on the different bones of the skull derived from neurocranium and viscerocranium and its derivatives. So skull has got two parts embryologically, neurocranium and the viscerocranium. What are the parts of the skull derived from neurocranium and what are the parts of the skull derived from viscerocranium? And at the end we'll discuss some common craniofacial defects. So these are the points on which you have to focus. So as far as your basic and short essays are concerned, these are the very important points and objectives. So the development of a skull. Previously, we have discussed the intramembranous and endochondral type of the ossifications. So we'll take references of these types of ossifications as well. So the skull is divided into two parts. One is the neurocranium. So neurocranium can give rise a protective case over the brain, and this protective case is called as, बेटा इसको क्या कहते हैं, जो ऊपर केस होता है स्कल के, that is called as calvaria or vault of skull. So the neurocranium forms protective covering around the brain. It is derived from occipital somites. So when you will recall that what was the source of origin, कि बेटा स्कल में कौन से layers contribute कर रहे थे, that is pharyngeal mesoderm, some part of lateral plate mesoderm and neural crest cells. So pharyngeal mesoderm will be segmented to form the somites. So vault is derived from occipital somites. So skull is divided into two parts, neurocranium and viscerocranium. Neurocranium will give rise the vault of the skull and obviously the base. So vault is actually derived from, by the membranous neurocranium, and base is by the cartilaginous neurocranium. And viscerocranium forming the skeleton of the face, the facial skeleton. And there's a big contribution of neural crest cells for the facial skeleton. Clear? Generally, is divided into neurocranium and the viscerocranium. Neurocranium will give rise to mainly the upper part, and the viscerocranium is actually responsible for the development of facial skeleton, and there is a big contribution of neural crest cells. This is a picture showing you the vault, how the vault is derived. We'll actually discuss this first picture later on in detail, that how these spicules are derived to form the different bones of the vault of the skull. And this is the picture of base of the skull. This is the superior view. Base has got its inferior view as well, which you have already done in your gross classes. If we'll talk about the cranial vault, it consists of different bones, and all these bones are present in this picture. There is a frontal bone, parietal, occipital, temporal bone, sphenoid bone. So all these are the bones contributing to form the vault of the skull. And this slide is actually from your gross anatomy. This is the base showing you both of these views. There's a superior view. Contributing bones are again frontal, sphenoid bone, there's a temporal bone and occipital bone. From the base, you can see different bones. That is maxillary, palatine, there's the zygomatic, this is the vomer, sphenoid, temporal and occipital bone. So neurocranium can give rise vault and the base, but bones of the vault contributed by the membranous neurocranium and bones of the base contributed by the cartilaginous neurocranium. This is the facial skeleton. So there's a big contributor. There is a neural crest cells. The blue structured bones are mainly contributed by the neural crest cells. And the bones with the red colors contributed by paraxial mesoderm. And everybody knows this thing, that the paraxial mesoderm will segment it to form the somites. And above the occipital somites, there will be the somatomeres, which will give rise to bones with the red colors that are the parietal bone, petrous part of temporal bone, the occipital bone. And here you can also see the hyoid bone and laryngeal cartilages, mainly the thyroid and the cricoid cartilage. And these blue, yellow structures are contributed by lateral plate mesoderm. So you have seen all the contributors that are actually the source of origin, which can give rise to the craniofacial skeleton. So more specifically, I have shown you through different colors in the bones and the source of origin. So neural crest cells, paraxial mesoderm and lateral plate mesoderm collectively give rise to the craniofacial skeleton. So this is very interesting picture. This is the imaginary line which is passes through the mastoid process at the superciliary ciliary arches. This imaginary line passes through this area just to demarcate. This imaginary line which will demarcate the viscerocranium and the neurocranium. So the structures above this line are formed by the neurocranium and below by the viscerocranium. Again, these are the bones from neurocranium. These are the different bones: frontal, parietal, temporal, occipital. This is the ethmoid bone and the sphenoid bone, the eight cranial bones. And these are the 14 facial bones. Beta, aapne gross mein padha hai skull?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
So you will learn all the details related to these bones in your gross anatomy. I'll just show you all these bones, then the bones of the vault of the skull and the bones of the facial skeleton. They are coming from different sources. We have discussed the neurocranium and the viscerocranium. So as far as embryology is concerned, just focus on the source of origin, that what are the layers giving rise these bones, and line of demarcation, that what are the bones derived by the neurocranium and the viscerocranium. You will learn all the names in your gross anatomy. Beta, naam aap yaad kar lenge. Ye nasal bone hai, this is the blue one, is the lacrimal bone, inferior nasal concha. These are the bones present at the lateral wall of the nose. Palatine bone, this is the vomer bone, the maxilla, yellow structure, and the mandible. These all are the facial bones. Beta, ye aap acche se yaad karenge, padhenge in bones ke features in your gross anatomy. प्लीज टर्न ऑफ योर माइक्रोफोन इन दिस वे यू कैन इजीली डिस्ट्रैक्ट द क्लास. Please be careful, otherwise मैं आप लोगों को remove कर दूंगी. So now we'll discuss in detail the membranous neurocranium. So neurocranium is divided into two. One is the membranous, another is cartilaginous. So membranous neurocranium is mainly derived from neural crest cells and paraxial mesoderm. So this is very important point that the membranous neurocranium is the source of origin. Kya hai? So what is the source of origin for the membranous neurocranium? That is neural crest cell and paraxial mesoderm. In the mesenchyme of those two sources undergo membranous ossification, resulting in number of flat membranous bone. They are characterized by the presence of needle-like bone spicules, which I have shown you in this picture. These are the bone spicules. It arises at the level of the flat bones derived from membranous neurocranium, contributed by neural crest cells and paraxial mesoderm. These spicules progressively radiate from primary ossification centers to the periphery. So first these spicules, bony spicules, will be formed at the level of these membranous bones, the cranial bones. And the second one is a cartilaginous neurocranium. So cartilaginous neurocranium, also called as chondrocranium, initially consists of number of the separate cartilages. Those that lie in front of the notochord, which ends at the level of pituitary gland. So the pituitary gland is lying at the area called as cella tersica. So the cella tersica is the landmark. In front of the cella tersica, there is the role of chondrocranium, and this part is called as procaudal chondrocranium, procaudal, in front of the notochord. And some parts of the bone are derived behind the cella tersica. That is called as caudal chondrocranium. So pre-caudal and the caudal, this term defined that the structures develop in front of the notochord and behind the notochord. So the bone that are lie in front of the notochord are derived from neural crest cells. So the procaudal chondrocranium is derived from neural crest cells, and those that lie posterior to this limit arises from occipital sclerotomes and the paraxial mesoderm. The base of the skull is formed when these cartilages fuse and ossify by endochondral ossification. So firstly, all the bones which are derived from cartilaginous neurocranium, firstly, these are as a cartilage. They'll fuse at the midline from right to left halves to form the different bones. So this is actually the landmark, that the body of the sphenoid. In front of this landmark, there are certain bones, and behind this landmark, there are certain bones. So we have the ethmoid. It has got right and left halves. So these right and left halves of these bones previously formed as the cartilages, and afterwards, after the development, they will fuse at the midline to form the bone. So there is the ethmoid bone having its two halves, the right and the left half. We'll have lesser wing of the sphenoid having its right and the left half. We'll have greater wing of the sphenoid. Okay, and then there is a body of the sphenoid which is present at the center. So it is contributed by both of these two sources, that is the neural crest cells and the occipital sclerotum. This is the base of the occipital bone, the petrous part of the occipital bone, and this is the foramen magnum. So the blue structures, bones that form the, that are actually rostral, that is the in front to the half of the cella tersica, arises from neural crest cells and constitute the precaudal chondrocranium. Precaudal, that means in front of the notochord. And those forming posterior to this landmark arises from paraxial mesoderm. So behind the notochord, there is a term for this area, that is caudal chondrocranium. So all this base of a skull is derived by the chondrocranium, That is intracartilaginous neurocranium. So neurocranium is divided into two, that is membranous and cartilaginous. Cartilaginous is divided into two, one part in front of the notochord called as precordal and behind the landmark, behind this landmark, that is called as caudal chondrocranium. So precordal is derived from neural crest cells and caudal chondrocranium is derived from parietal mesoderm. So you must have to focus that the, what are the bones present in front of this landmark and what are the bones present behind this landmark. So what are the derivatives of precordal part and what are the derivatives of caudal part of the chondrocranium? Now are you getting this point? It is very simple that what are the bones present in front of the notochord? What are the bones developing behind the notochord? So it's very simple. So in front, jo aage banenge jo bhi, that is ethmoid, greater and the lesser wing of sphenoid, they are derived from the neural crest cells and half of the part of the body of the sphenoid, half of the part of body of the sphenoid, base of the occipital bone and petrous part of the temporal bone, these are derived from the parietal mesoderm. Next is the viscerocranium. So viscerocranium consists of the bones of the face, mainly from the first two pharyngeal arches. So there is a contribution of first two pharyngeal arches as well, along with the contribution of neural crest cells. So the first arch gave rise to the maxilla, the zygomatic bone, and the part of the temporal bone. I'm going to show you these bones. So this one is maxilla, the main facial bone. And this green structure is zygomatic bone. The first arch will give rise maxilla, the zygomatic bone and part of the temporal bone. The ventral portion give rise the mandible. The dorsal tip of the mandibular process will give rise the two bones of the ear, that is incus and the malleus. And second pharyngeal arch will give rise the third bone, that is stapes. And these small bones which are present in the middle ear cavity, they are the first bone to ossify. And its ossification starts in the fourth month. And these are the first bones of the body to be fully ossified. And mesenchyme for the formation of bone of the face is derived from neural crest cells. Clear? So there is a role of neural crest cells and first two pharyngeal arches in the facial skeleton is right from viscerocranium. So in other words, viscerocranium consists of facial skeleton and this facial skeleton is contributed by neural crest cells and first two pharyngeal arches. This is a picture. All the pictures are mainly taken from your Vieters, from your Langman, the textbook of embryology. This is a lateral view of head and neck region in the fetus, showing you the derivatives of cartilages participating in the formation of bones of the face. So you can see over here, there is a zygomatic bone. This one, and this is the maxilla. This is the mainly the squamous part of the temporal bone. and this is the mandible. This is the contribution of first two pharyngeal arches. Stapes, incus and malleus, and then stapes. Stapes is contributed by second pharyngeal arch. Incus and malleus contributed by first pharyngeal arch. So you learn all these things when you will take the lecture related to the pharyngeal arches. Pharyngeal arches pe hua hai aapka lecture?
No, ma'am.
When you learn all the pharyngeal arches, first, second, fifth, all these pharyngeal arches, pharyngeal cleft, pharyngeal apparatus पे आपकी क्लास होगी. So यहाँ पे आप लोगों ने ये लर्न करना है that what are the derivatives of urocranium and the viscerocranium, and more specifically you will learn in the lecture of pharyngeal apparatus के कौन सी आर्च से क्या ड्राइव होगा. In the development of the skull, this is a bit summary with the cartilaginous viscerocranium. First arch will give rise malleus and incus. Second arch will give rise stapes, styloid process, and part of the hyoid bone. So here you can see the blue structure, that is the styloid process and the part of the hyoid bone. Here you can also see the picture. With the viscerocranium, mainly give rise facial skeleton, and there is also the contribution of first two pharyngeal arches. So more specifically, first arch will give rise malleus and incus. These are the bones of the ear, small bones, and second arch will give rise stapes, the smallest bone of the body. Styloid process and part of the hyoid bone. This is a styloid process, and this one is hyoid bone. Please follow the cursor. And membranous viscerocranium includes mandible, zygomatic, maxilla, and squamous part of the temporal bone. So this is the summary related to the viscerocranium. This is a very helpful picture. And all these things may coming in your BCQs, that what are the derivatives of cartilaginous viscerocranium and main contribution of pharyngeal arch. That what are the structures derived from first pharyngeal arch, and what are the structures derived from second pharyngeal arch, and what are the derivatives of membranous viscerocranium. This is a picture showing you the different bones derived from viscerocranium. Ye bhi interesting isliye lagi kyunki this picture is showing you the unpaired and the paired bones. So mandible, this is a jaw bone, this is the unpaired bone, and vomer bone, it is present at the level of the nose, it is also the unpaired. Maxilla, zygomatic, nasal, lacrimal, palatine, and inferior concha. All these bones of facial skeleton are paired bone, and they are fused at the midline. This is a newborn skull. At the birth, flat bones are separated by the sutures and frontanels. Frontanels are the big gaps between these sutures. Cranial capacity increases very little after 5 to 7 years of age due to the fusion of these sutures and frontanels. Some sutures remain open until adulthood. And palpitation of anterior frontanel provides valuable information on proper ossification of the skull. So this anterior frontanel, which is a gap between these sutures, it's covered by the membrane. This is giving the big clue towards many clinical conditions. Like in small children, we can see the ossification, we can see the dehydration in the children after the diarrhea. So there's the importance of frontanels. So these are the gaps between the sutures. These membranous bone are articulated by the sutures. Mainly we have the anterior and the posterior front tunnels. We'll have also the posterior lateral or the mastoid front tunnel. Anterior front tunnel is very important as far as its clinical significance is concerned. You can clearly see over here the anterior front tunnel, the big one, posterior front tunnel and posterior lateral are mastoid front tunnel. You can see this front tunnel is bulging out. And if there will be the dehydration, you can see sunken front tunnel. So front tunnel depress hoga agar bacche mein dehydration hogi after the diarrhea. Anterior front tunnel closes by 18 months of age. And posterior front tunnel is closes by 1 to 2 months of age. And this thing is very important. Many times you people are asked like that, at what age anterior front tunnel fuses or closes and the closure of posterior front tunnel. This is a very interesting picture. We can actually differentiate when we look at the different skulls. So newborn skull is like this. And if the skull is of 3 years of age, the face is looking smaller and vault is looking bigger.
Discuss four
craniosynostosis, there are two varieties. One is early closure of the sagittal suture called as scaphopuffy, and early closure of lambdoid or the coronal suture. Lambdoid suture is present at the posterior part of the cranial cavity, and coronal suture at the, this one is the lambdoid suture. Specifically, the clinicals related to your